In this program, the vocal group JUSTUS will be performing sacred classical music written by composers whose lives span over 500 years of the history of Western music. These 500 years are often subdivided by music historians into five broad periods of time, namely the Renaissance, the Baroque, the Classical period, the Romantic period, and the Modern period. In our concert, we will be singing short examples of church music from each of these five periods. We begin with two compositions dating back to the Renaissance, a period which stretched from roughly 1400 to 1600 AD. First, music by the Italian composer Claudio Monteverdi, born in Cremona in the year 1567, and then music by the composer Thomas Tallis, born somewhere in England, no one is quite sure exactly where, around the year 1505.
Monteverdi's Beatosphere, Blessed is the man who fears the Lord, he delights greatly in his commandments, was probably composed around 1630 when Monteverdi was working as master of music at St. Mark's Cathedral in Venice. It is characteristic of Monteverdi's boldly original style, bright and lively with frequent alternating exchanges between the vocal parts.
Monteverdi's Beatosphere seems to sparkle with sunlight and Mediterranean warmth. Our second example of Renaissance music, a short work by Thomas Tallis, is equally characteristic of Tallis's own time and place. his anthem, If Ye Love Me, with words from John chapter 14, verse 15 to 17, is subdued and reflective, and the subtle interplay of interweaving melodic phrases expresses a quiet but profound depth of spirituality. The effect created by this woven texture is quite striking. It is as if released from the tyranny of a strict metrical beat, the spirit is set free.
If the contrast between the music of the Renaissance composers Monteverdi and Talis might be said to reflect the outward-looking and extrovert character of the Italian Monteverdi and the more inward-looking introvert nature of the Englishman Talis, the same could easily be applied to George Frederick Handel and Johann Sebastian Bach, the two figures who dominate the musical landscape of the Baroque period, roughly from 1600 to 1750.
Handel was a German-born composer who traveled widely before settling in England, where he lived and composed for some 50 years. He was an accomplished performer, a prolific composer, and a successful businessman, amassing significant wealth and respect by the time of his death in 1759. Handel loved the fast pace of London life and reveled in the adulation of his many fans. He was also a lover of the theatre, and although perhaps best known for his sacred oratorio, The Messiah, a great deal of his output was devoted to secular music and to providing music required by the royal court for ceremonial occasions. For the coronation of King George II in 1727, Handel composed four anthems, one of which, Zadok the Priest, has been performed in every single coronation of a British monarch ever since. Our selection is taken from another one of his fine anthems, The King Shall Rejoice. And its text proclaims that the Lord shall be exceedingly glad for the King's salvation, concluded in typical Handelian fashion with an elaborate six-part fugue with just a one-word text, Alleluia.
Exceeding glad shall he be, exceeding glad, ever glad.
Johann Sebastian Bach was in musical temperament and personal inclination Handel's exact opposite. Born in the same year as Handel, Bach traveled little and, although writing some courtly music, devoted most of his extensive output to compositions for the church, all dedicated to God's greater glory. He enjoyed none of Handel's worldly fame and never sought it. Indeed, his present fame, he is widely regarded these days as one of the greatest of all classical composers, only started to grow some 200 years after his death, when some of his compositions were rediscovered and in some cases given their first performance. The contrast between these two giants of the Baroque period can also be seen in their music. Handel's popularity in his day, as well as to this day, may have much to do with genius for composing catchy rhythms, strong chordal progressions, and very singable and memorable melodies. Bach's music, on the other hand, is widely regarded as having greater intellectual depth and being more challenging, qualities that may make his music difficult to play, and for some, even difficult to listen to, but which served to enhance the extraordinary beauty of his work. From Bach's Magnificat, composed in 1723, we now hear Christel Valsen and Glenn Lake sing the duet Et Misericordia, His Mercy Is of Generations on Those Who Fear Him.
Genius, evil genius, evil
Just as Bach and Handel are widely recognized as the undisputed great pillars of the Baroque period of musical history, so are Haydn and Mozart hailed as the two most outstanding composers of classical music's own classical period, which spanned roughly from 1750 to 1820. The saying that men achieve great heights by climbing on the backs of those that went before them is as true for classical music as for so many other areas of human endeavor. The music of Bach and Handel would not have been possible without the influence of the many great Renaissance composers whose music they so admired. Great composers learn from their predecessors, but then take their influences and mold them through their own creative processes to form a personal and unique musical identity, which then places them head and shoulders above the rest. This was certainly true for Mozart. Whilst his contemporaries often had problems with his behavior, which they sometimes found to be outrageously delinquent, they were forced to admit that his natural ability had absorbed the music of his predecessors and transformed it into an amazing level of sublime artistic achievement. Indeed, so great was the contrast between the man and his music that they could only understand the music by believing his compositions had come down, quote, straight from God.
Despite the great awe in which Mozart's music was held, his life was short. He was only 35 at the time of his death and not particularly happy. He was plagued with marital and financial problems and suffered increasingly from bad health. There is a famous backstory to this music that we now sing, which comes from his Requiem Mass. The story goes like this. Mozart was both critically ill and in serious financial trouble when he received the commission to compose a Requiem Mass from a hooded messenger who did not want to reveal the identity of the person who had sent him. Such was Mozart's need for the commission that though he barely had the strength to compose, he agreed. As he worked feverishly to meet his deadline, the music came to fill him with foreboding. It seemed that he was not composing the music for a wealthy aristocrat who intended to pass the work off as his own, as Mozart had originally thought, but rather that he had been commissioned to write a Requiem Mass for himself. As it happened, Mozart did pass away before he could complete the score. It was in due course completed by one of his students based on sketches that Mozart had left, but it was not performed at his funeral. Indeed, unlike the grand send-off given in Vienna just a few years later for the funeral of Ludwig van Beethoven, Mozart's obvious successor, Mozart was buried without ceremony in an unmarked pauper's grave outside of the walls of Vienna. From Mozart's Requiem Mass, the vocal group Justus performs Hostias. We offer thee, Lord, sacrifices and prayers of praise. Do thou accept them for those souls whom we this day commemorate. Grant them, O Lord, to pass from death to life, which thou once did promise to Abraham and his seed. The movement falls in two distinct sections, and it is worth noting that the weaving of voices in the second section pays evident homage to the fugues of George Frederick Handel.
To suit you,
What can be clearly seen as the trends of musical history are traced from one period to the next is that as the years pass, the earlier unifying characteristics of style become increasingly fragmented. This process begins as we enter the period referred to as the Romantic period, which was roughly from 1820 to the early 20th century. The music of Haydn and Mozart summed up an era in which order, balance, and careful formal structures, a certain objective elegance of expression, were valued and cultivated. But beginning with Beethoven, these aspects give way increasingly to a much more individualistic need to express subjective personal feelings in new ways, using looser and larger formal structures, a more overtly emotional and complex harmonic language, larger instrumental resources, and a growing tendency to recognize the folk music of the composer's native land as a rich source of inspiration for larger compositions. As a result, the Romantic period is much more diverse in its composers and their styles than had ever been the case before. So it is no surprise that the three Romantic period composers that we feature in this program, Mendelssohn, Bruckner, and Berlioz, seem to have so little in common, other than perhaps their shared respect for the composers who came before them. It was, after all, Mendelssohn who devoted a great deal of his time to promoting Bach's music. And it was Mendelssohn who gave the first performances of Bach's scores, which he had discovered lying on dusty shelves where they had been undisturbed for some 200 years since Bach's death. But in many ways, Mendelssohn had even more in common with Handel than with Bach. Like Handel, he spent a great deal of his time in England, and also like Handel, he wrote sacred oratorios, concert works based on biblical stories that became hugely popular with choirs throughout England, and revealed in the way the chorus numbers were composed his love for Baroque contrapuntal writing, where the same melody can weave between different voices starting at different times, which is such a hallmark of the popular choruses in Handel's Messiah.
Blessed are the men who fear him, using the same text as Monteverdi in Beatus Vere, but now in Elijah, illustrates well some of the trademark features of Mendelssohn's style, his gift for writing, inspiring simple melodies, his love for the complex interweaving of voices in the Baroque manner, and the use of grand chordal statements.
Yeah.
Though Christus Factus Est was composed 3 years before Mendelssohn's Elijah, it reveals a harmonic boldness that suggests Bruckner was well ahead of his time and certainly marching to his own drummer. Bruckner's link to his past is directly through Bach, whose music he revered, because like Bach, he was similarly devoted to his church, and all his compositions, even those without words, were dedicated to God. Again, like Bach, he traveled little and sought no fame. He was extremely humble by nature and always doubted the merits of his own work. Bruckner's reputation, like Bach's, has only grown with time. His music, even to modern ears, has a powerful appeal and has come to be very popular with members of the Justus group. Christus Factus Est was composed as an Easter gradual with words from Philippians chapter 2, verse 8 to 9. Christ became obedient for us unto death, even to death, death on the cross.
Thank you.
The music of the French composer Hector Berlioz, like that of Bruckner, is equally remarkable for being highly original and for having a very distinctive romantic style. Berlioz, like many romantic composers, was noted for having a profound love for literature and the power of the word. Most of his compositions have strong literary associations and reveal a gift for long melodic lines that seem to always lead the listener onto somewhere new and unexpected. Berlioz composed his first oratorio, The Childhood of Christ, in 1854, and though the complete work is not now often performed, it contains a very popular Christmas hymn called The Shepherd's Farewell. This short hymn in three verses has a very typical flowing Berlioz melody with quite unusual harmonic progressions and a shifting point of view in the text. In the first verse, the shepherds address the baby Jesus directly and exhort Mary and Joseph to shelter the babe with tender care. In the second verse, the shepherds beg Jesus as he grows and travels not to forget them, us who linger there. In the very quiet and slower third verse, the text returns to Mary and Joseph, exhorting them to guard you well your heavenly treasure, and closes praying that God will guide them safely through the wild.
Oh,
If the main trend in the 19th century Romantic period was for far greater expression of individuality, with the transition to more modern times, there is evidently an even greater predicament facing a composer trying to discover his own voice and musical identity amid the ever-expanding plethora of musical styles and possibilities. In the face of uncertainty about the right path to take, one decision chosen by some has been to turn their backs on the forward-looking trends of the present and instead root their identity safely in the musical language of the past. The French composer Gabriel Fauré finished revising his Requiem Mass in the year 1900, at the birth of the 20th century. It was a time when, in many parts of Europe, the musical language of serious composition was beginning to aggressively reinvent itself with features such as discordant atonal harmonies, angular and unsingable melodies, and highly irregular rhythms, in order to forge a new musical language seeming more relevant to the modern age. These new developments appealed little to Fauré at this time. His route, like Berlioz before him, would be to rejoice in expressive lyrical melodies and a harmonic language that, whilst occasionally bold and perhaps unexpected, could still easily capture the listener's ear.
Fauré's Requiem Mass remains to this date his most popular large-scale work, and as you will hear now, the Liberame section is well-founded in traditional harmony which supports a hauntingly beautiful melody. The movement does have a dramatic middle section where the rapidly shifting harmonies and sustained climax are used to express the forthcoming Day of Judgment. But the first melody soon returns now, with the whole choir singing the melody in unison, as if to remind the listener that, in the end, whatever our station in life, or for that matter, our part in the choir, we are united as one voice in our need to be delivered from death without end and to be granted eternal rest.
Liberame. Domine, de morte eterna, in die in la tremenda, in die in la, quando c'è
thank you.
Like Fory, at least in his Requiem, the contemporary Welsh composer Sir Carl Jenkins also has no problem using a harmonic language firmly rooted in the past. Like Tallis, Bach, and Bruckner, nearly all of Jenkins' music is devoted to his Christian faith, and many of his Catholic masses written in Latin have become popular with choirs all around the world. We end this program with his quiet and moving setting of the prayer Laudamus Te, from his large-scale work, The Gloria, composed in 2010. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you.